it's a great privilege and pleasure to have a chance to talk to Ronald Blythe, whose work I've known for many years. Can I call you Ronald or Ronnie?
Usually Ronnie.
Ronnie, yes. Okay. When and where were you born?
I was born at Acton, a village between Laverham and Sudbury, in 1922, November the 6th, St. Leonard's Day.
Yes. The day after the fireworks.
Day after the fireworks.
And tell me something about your ancestry and parentage.
Well, the Norman Scarfe, the Suffolk historian, says that the family had been in Suffolk for centuries, and there's a part of Suffolk called the Blythings and the River Blythe and Blytheborough, etc., and that he thinks I must have come from there. But I've never looked up the family, except that in the churchyards and things you do see distant relations who worked on farms or were shepherds or small farmers, old-fashioned, hardy-like country people. Mm. And then I am mother to a very bookish, read tons of books and things like that. And I got a job as the reference librarian at Colchester.
Let's slow it down a bit. Tell me something about, I mean, your father's family were Suffolk farmers, and your mother's family were...
They came from London, and they, I suppose, I don't know what some guys, clerk in the city, I don't know what they were really. Mm. No, yes. Mother went to school in London, and she went to church at St. Clement Danes. Mm. And she was very influenced by a woman missionary in Ceylon. And this Ceylonese, as they called them in those days, school made my christening robes and my brothers too. I think we all had them. It kind of romance it all was. None of us had been there except later on, much later on, her mother went to Australia. They called in at Ceylon. It was like to her some amazing thing, really. Anyway, I eventually got a job at Colchester Library, which is the public library. It had two other libraries, one an 18th century one. It was called a gentleman's library, when people gave a book each sort of thing and they distributed. But this was the ordinary library service where I was. And I was a reference librarian. And there's also Archbishop Hasnett's library, which is a Tudor library, an 8th Tudor library. Archbishop Hasnett was the Archbishop of York in the early 17th century. And in a way, it was my university, really, because I was very scholarly and read all the books, in a sense. And then I started the Colchester Literary Society, and all sorts of writers used to come. And then this rather delightful, to me, seemed elderly lady came in, the wife of John Nash, the painter, because I met her by this time, a lot of artists, including particularly Sir Cedric Morris, who had an art school called the, what was it called? It was 3 guineas a week, bring your own sheets. His first pupil was Lucian Freud. And when Cedric died many, many years later, I had to do all his papers and put them in an archive. And I found a letter from Lucian's father saying, I think my son is an artist, would you like to take him on? What I did do for a lot of these people was to look after all their papers. Mm. They never did anything to look after them, really. Well, then Christine Nash, John Nash's wife, wouldn't really allow me to stay on as a librarian because I was a poet. And she said, you know, I must write. So I had a little tiny bit of money, and she knew somebody who had a 19th century bungalow near Aldborough. My brother drove me over in the snow one day, and that's when I began to write. I wrote my first book there, which is a novel called A Treasonable Growth. And I also wrote some poems there. And then I'm trying to think what I did next. I began to meet other writers, particularly this man James Turner, who was another generation to myself. And he bought Borley Rectory, called the most haunted house in England. He was psychic, and his wife too, but I didn't believe any of that. But I loved being with him, talking about literature and books and things. And from then on, I simply wrote. I wrote stories and sent them up, and poems, and wrote a novel called A Treasonable Growth. And then I met W.R. Rogers, the Irish poet. And he introduced me to some publisher or other who gave me work to do. Oh, then they began the Penguin English Library, that's right, yes, I've forgotten. And this, the idea of this was to have certain wonderful works of literature with a long introduction and lots of notes, which people would read, but not in the sense of having to study anything, but just to understand a particular novel. And the first novel I did was Jane Austen's Emma. And then I did my hero, William Hazlitt. And I think I'm the president of the Hazlitt Society. Then I became one of the editors of the New Wessex edition of Thomas Hardy. And I edited and introduced Far From the Madding Crows and A Pair of Blue Eyes and other Hardy things. And bit by bit, I began to be writing my own books, short stories and poems and things, and doing this literary work. I never got a proper job, as they say. I just eventually found myself a little house in Suffolk. And I lived then as I live now, really. Then my books began to be published in the States. Then I went abroad sometimes, but not often. And people offered me kind of professorships and things like that. But I didn't, I always just stayed at home writing. And so I've written a lot of books, short stories and novels, and edited some of the classics and books of essays. It's rather, I suppose, an old-fashioned literary life. This, my whole life has been like that, really.
How do you write? I mean, do you...
I write by hand, mm-hmm, on nice ruled foolscap. Then I type them up.
Mm.
And now Vicky, my friend, she puts them on a computer.
Mm.
Yes, which I can't use. I've never tried to do it, really.
And do you write... Do you have a special writing room and desk, or...?
Yeah, yes, I do, really. It's I'll show it to you, if you like. It's the study is over this room.
Mm, I'd like to see that.
Yes. Would you like to look at it, or see it later on?
See it later on.
Well...
And do you... You sit at a desk and write at the desk?
Yes.
And do you write in the mornings, or...?
Yes, always in the mornings, if possible. From 10 to 1, usually.
Mm. Mm. Do you rewrite a lot? Or when you type it, do you change it a lot?
Not a great deal, really. I love the act of writing. And then, as you see, I've got doing the proof of the book here.
Mm. And you like correcting the proofs and...
Yes, I do rather. You can't mess and read, you have to put a line underneath. Mm. It's be very careful not to. You can't let anyone else do it either, because you can't trust them in a sense. I just give a week up to a book. This one is called From the Artist's House, about being, living here really. Then I also do a weekly column in the Church Times. Very famous, I say, written by all the bishops, read by all the bishops and things. And that's 400 words a week. I wrote it yesterday. I sent all my work through the post in an envelope to the publishers, that's right. And if they query, they ring me up. And I've never been to the office. I think one of the things you have to be careful if you're a writer is not to be distracted. People often want you to do things you can't do, or to come to London or do all sorts of things. But I have a circle of friends here, old friends, some of them, and some younger. Like yesterday, I had to give this great day's talk to the University of Suffolk. It's another world meeting these people of this age. They're delightful, absolutely wonderful, and some of them want to write. And so I've done that sometimes. I've been a member of the Arts Council and of a lot of academic things. I'm a fellow and things like that, and a doctor. But on that whole, these are just honours. I was given one this week, which is absolutely lovely, but it's a treat, really, to go.
So the University of East Anglia, was that the one?
No, this is the University of Suffolk.
Oh.
Yes. But I am of East Anglia, yes, that's right, yes, yes. It's probably in the study upstairs.
We'll have a look when we go
up.
Well, can you, if you had to give some advice to a young person who wants to write, what would you say to them?
Well, one of the great things is to write. I encountered a number of times people who thought in bestseller terms or something like that. But it's rather like telling them learning the piano. You must practice, sort of thing. And most of us are very influenced by some writer we love when we're young.
Who were they in your case?
One of them was Scott Mountcreef's translation of Proust. Immensely important. I should read it. Oh, it's an enormous great 7 volume. So I read it constantly, really. And I read Yeats a lot.
The poetry or the prose or both?
Mostly the poetry, yes.
And Hardy?
Hardy all the time, yes, that's right. And when they did the New Wessex edition, the first one was 1928, the year of Hardy's death. I have what you might call a retentive memory. I don't know what to, I don't say this in a bragging sense, but on the whole, I can remember things. Where they are. I did a book called The Age of Illusion about the 20s and 30s, which I wrote at Cambridge in the university library a long time ago. I wrote a lot of essays. I just write in a normal way. Often when I'm doing the garden or looking after the house and no one's coming, I get into a daydream of just writing, in a sense. I imagine it's a fairly old-fashioned literary way of thinking.
Do you have a lot of thoughts when you're doing other things, like going for a walk? Or
yes, all the time. Walking,
Walking helps.
Yeah, it does, that's right. Salvatore Ambulando, you can work it out by walking.
Yeah, indeed.
Yes.
The legs are the wheels of creativity, as Einstein said.
That's right. Well, Christine Nash was very influential, and when I was young, I used to like chatting to her because she knew a lot of Bloomsbury people. But at 10 o'clock sharp, she would say, "Now, dear, where are you going to work?" And I had to leave and go in a corner somewhere. I write in the garden in the summertime.
Do you?
Yes.
You don't find it distracting?
No, I just love it, really, the sun.
Sitting in a comfortable chair and just write, or do you have a desk? Or
I do into it inside, but otherwise I might just be lolling on the grass or something. Yes, like John Clare. When they founded the John Clare Society in 50 years ago, they asked Charles Causley to be the president, and he's a friend of mine, And he said, well, I live in Cornwall, ask Ronnie, because he lives up this way. So, and so I became the president, and I have been, and I've just resigned after all these many years. So I've written a lot about John Clare, and done collections of things about him. I think not having a family, maybe the days, you know, they're undisturbed. The house is extremely remote, you can't hear any traffic here.
Yes.
And so I read and write and listen to music, and on Sundays I go to church. That's about what I do.
You say you listen to music. What music do you like?
Any kind of it. Well, not no, that's not true. It would be classical, as they call it these days, classical music. Not popular music. Not that I have. I know nothing about it really. Yeah. That's right. Yeah.
And within classical music, what particularly?
Well, it'd be Bach and Mozart and early music, early church music, and folk music, folk song, like, you know, Georgian folk song music, really. We go to concerts occasionally at Albury, which is about 40 miles from here, to which I'm attached, really.
Well, you have an attachment to Albury, because I think you mentioned that you lived in Benjamin Britten's house for a period, is that right?
No, I lived near him, in his house, that's right.
Yeah.
And I went to the house lots of times.
And you worked for him?
Yes.
Doing what?
The literary side, really, of the festivals. The Albury Festival publishes a wonderful book, called the Programme Book. It's more than that, it's got essays in, and it's kind of a wonderful thing, really, with photographs and drawings and things. And I edited one of those for him a long time ago. And I'm often, I'm connected with a lot of Albury people, the Garrett family, who built the Maltings in the 19th century. And my friend Dennis Garrett was a botanist, and his wife, they lived in Cambridge. So I knew all those people. All these people seem to me to work quietly without any fuss, doing all sorts of things. But it was really coming to stay and live with John Nash, who was another generation altogether, and also very well read, and his wife Christine, which...
You came to live with them?
No, I used to come and look after the house when they went away.
Yeah.
And sometimes stay with them, Yes.
What was, going back to Albury and the music festival, I mean, did you know other members of the... I mean, what was Benjamin Britten like as a person, and Peter Pears?
Well, Ben was, I suppose you might call him exacting, a kind of, could be demanding and difficult. I sang one of the choirs when I was young, not that I can sing properly at all, in the church. But, and I've given lectures there sometimes, at Snake Maltings. And the Maltings were built by my friends the Garretts, their great-grandfather.
And Piers was, what was he like?
I hardly knew him, really. I often saw him. He seemed to be a rather big presence, standing at the back, smiling. Mm. Britten was anything but that. He was tense. And nervous, and looking back, extremely good to me. They were surrounded by umpteen people. I don't know how they worked, really. House was full of all kinds of people coming in and out.
You knew Imogen Hulst well.
She was lovely. She was marvellous. She was my kind of the saint, in a way. Once Ben was abroad, and Peter, and we had to get the program book done ourselves in 1956. And it was quite a great piece. I sat with Imogen in her house. We worked at Gustav Holst's desk, music desk. And we put it all together, quietly, no fuss, anything like that. She was absolutely splendid. Wonderful, wonderful woman. They're all buried together in a little corner of Auburn churchyard, Ben and Peter and Imogen. But I'd also known the place at Thaxted where Gustav Holst lived. And I used to go across and stay with a friend there who lived in a rectory, which is just up the road from there. In fact, we went there quite recently. I was really connected with an earlier kind of culture, really, I suppose, in East Anglia. Yeah.
You knew, or you met E.M. Forster. How did that happen?
Well, this is unbelievable, really. When Christine Nash found me this place at Thorpe Ness to start to be a writer, and it was winter and snowing, I went there on the 1st of January. And my brother drove me over. And I went to get some shopping one day. It's all in this book. And I came back and I found a letter pushed under, or rather a page from a notebook, pushed under the door, and it said, "Dear Mr. Blythe, would you care to come and have a drink with us tonight, E.M. Forster?" Well, it's like somebody like saying, "Would you like to come to drink tonight, Shakespeare, to me?" I couldn't believe it, really. Anyway, I walked all the way back, and because I'd been a librarian, I knew how to do indexing, and he was indexing the life he'd written
of
Marion Thornton, the great aunt, or brother, I can't remember, who
left
him enough money to live without getting a job, that's right. Yeah.
Wrote a biography of Lewis Dickinson too, didn't he?
He did, yeah, that's right.
What was Forster like?
Well, he was a shabby little man. used to help me do the shopping. He's very charming to me all the time. Very extremely kind. I was in awe of him, really. But later on, when I had done a lot of work for the festival and seen Forster quite a lot of times, that Imogen took us to the Wentworth, the posh hotel in Aldra, and gave us dinner together. I mean, I thought it was like going to the Ritz or something in those days. It's incredible. Yes. But eventually, after 2 or 3 years, I felt I had to escape from them all, to be myself. And so I found myself a little farmhouse at a village called Debbidge near Woodbridge, in the middle of nowhere, really. And I stayed there until I came here, over 25 years. And I wrote a lot of I wrote Akenfield there.
You wrote Akenfield there?
Yes.
How did you come to that idea of writing that well-known book?
It was an editor at Penguin Books, or Pantheon Books, whatever it's called. They commissioned a lot of rural studies, and the idea was to send a Frenchman to Russia and a Russian to France, and they should write about the rural life they saw in these countries. And a series came out, and so they came to me, and I thought I was going to go somewhere, and they said, "No, you stay at home." And so that's what happened, that's right. And so the book is very autobiographical, Akenfield.
Yeah. Which bits are most, I mean, do your parents appear in it?
Not
directly.
No. But in a sense, my knowledge of bell ringing or farming or all sorts of things is all my part of my background. It's right. I'm an honorary bell ringer. I can't ring any bells, but I wrote about bells and many of them. I'm honorary everything, really. That's right.
Quite a lot of the book is based on interviews,
yes,
oral history
Yes.
Before its time, as it were. You didn't use a tape recorder for that?
I did once or twice, not all the time. I mostly went to see people. The first one was the district nurse. She was the treasurer of the village church. But it's not proper oral history. It's just drawing together about 50 people and the different classes and things like that, as they were living around me at that time, and doing these little portraits of them, in a sense. I chose, it's rather absurd really, quite funny, I chose the names of the stones in the churchyard, but everybody knew who they all were about next week. It's all a waste of time, really.
Did anyone ever complain about anything?
No, I regret it. I thought they would. But a farmer's wife said to me, oh, my dear, you should come to me. I could have told you much worse than that. But I knew a lot about it already. I didn't have to be told many of those things. I also knew about farming. I knew about harvesting. And then Peter Hall, who came from Bellis and Edmonds, and who couldn't tell a daisy from a pumpkin, he'd had all his relations to his mother's and father's, I think, wedding anniversary. And my book upset him. He felt that somehow it escaped his real life. Yes, that cat. Yes. And he asked if he could film it. And I said, no, he couldn't. And then I met him. And then I did a kind of a version of the book as it could be filmed, rather like André Bresson or Pasolini. And this is what we filmed. Have you seen the film?
I have, yes.
Yeah. It took a year to make.
Mm. Who did the voiceover? It was rather a nice...
It was a marvellous man, even Felix there.
Suffolk voice.
A wonderful voice, that's right, yes. A dear man, that's right.
The accents are so enormously different.
Yes, well, I can remember that as a child.
You remember those accents?
Very much so, yes, yes. It's another language almost.
Yes.
As it went from Essex towards Norfolk, it got broader and broader.
Mm.
Yes.
The school in the film is a pretty savage place, with beatings and discipline. Well,
it was like that in many ways, yes.
Mm. Was that like your school? Or?
No, not really, no. It was before then, I think. Mm. I don't know what it was, but I heard about these bullets. Was the same in public schools.
Mm.
There was an enormous lot of beatings. Eton was famous for it. It was an incredible thing. The girls weren't touched, but the boys were constantly...
The girls were beaten on the hands, weren't they?
I don't know. Yes, but...
I mean, what is, when you wrote the book, did you see it as a portrait of a vanished world or a vanishing world?
Yes, I suppose I did to a degree, but it was in the 1960s and the world was vanishing without my realizing it, in a sense. Mm-hmm.
So it wasn't consciously?
No. It's not a requiem or anything like that. It is about agriculture and poverty and the church and chapel and climate, the understructure is all that kind of thing, much of it witnessed by myself. But I can't analyse it. One of the things that happens when books become well known, probably like Side with Rosie, Then they
take a life of their own.
They take a life of their own, that's right, yes.
I mean, you mentioned the church and the chapel, and I think I've heard you say that your mother was a very devout lady. What has been the role of religion in your life?
Oh, considerable, really. And I love it, really. But then I see it through poetry, like George Herbert, and music, and architecture, and things like that. And so there came a moment when the bishops used to try to persuade me to be ordained. One thing, I'm very inefficient, and I can't drive or do anything like that. I said, I couldn't cope with all this, really, at all. But it's incredible how church often wants to make you something you're not, in a sense. But I've got a stall in the cathedral at Bellis Edmonds.
And you're a canon of the...
I'm a canon, yes. And and here I'm what they call the reader.
Yeah. So you can take services?
I can take service every Sunday, yes. Mm.
How do you get to these places if you don't drive?
That's the only thing. I tell all of them, they all got cars. I said, I don't mind coming. The house is remote. I said, and I do all the music. But so I say, I don't drive, and you must come pick me up. They've all got cars, buildings, and things. They come and pick me up. That's right. I think that's their little duty, really. And they don't mind. That's right.
Mm. What about... You obviously like the beauty and continuity of the church. What about the theology and the dogma of the church? Do you...
Well, I suppose I'm rather conventional. I love the liturgy of the Church of England. And often, and certainly the hymns and the music. So my services are, I suppose, aesthetic to a degree. I give them a kind of literary talk for 10 minutes. Usually without notes. Takes an hour every Sunday. You've got the three churches, all lovely. The only thing that in village life, the church has umpteen other activities, you know, flower shows and hundreds of things like that. So on the whole, old age allows me to get out of all these, really. But it is part of my world here. And it's continuity, really, with my background. Because often artists and writers they don't quite belong, really, as you're admired, really, because you do these things, but you're clearly unlike anyone else, isn't it?
If you were asked whether there was a kind of central thread through your writings, because you write many books and poetry as well as prose, would you be able to discover it, or is it meander too much to be able to?
No, I think there is a thread, I should imagine, of deeply personal life, which goes back to boyhood, connected with nature and old traditions and solitude. And friendship, very big, right? I think these... I mean, I'm a very happy person, really. And depend upon a group of friends. And also on wonderful good health. I don't know how that happened. I've never really been ill. And I'm basically philosophical by nature, I think, about time. But I feel myself as belonging to the arts, and music, and literature, and poetry. It's my world, really. Mm.
When you said goes back to childhood and nature, it obviously has echoes of William Wordsworth and the way he and many poets draw on, like and Laurie Lee and others draw on their childhoods. Can you tell me a little more about your own childhood? I mean, what were your first memories, for example?
Well, a lot of it was to escape. That is, going off into the wilds of Suffolk, really, on my bike often enough. A sense of not quite fitting in some ways, but not unhappily so, just being absorbed in natural history and in reading, enormously so, and stuff, you know. And the history of Suffolk and East Anglia. And then gradually meeting other people, writers, and then people like Britain, who also belong to this world. And also receiving great kindness. I never thought of these people when I was young as celebrated in any way. I did lots of work for them. I felt as well I belonged in a way. I've never lived in London more than 4 days consecutively. And living alone, and nearly always alone, it's natural to me. In a way, so I've never shared the house with anyone. I just worked, and special friends come to stay and things like that. It's not uncommon, really.
When you mentioned going off on your bike alone, you weren't a kind of Richmond Crompton kind of just William.
No, Richmond Crompton.
You weren't part of a gang of friends.
No, far from it.
Hmm. No. And at school also, you didn't have many close friends.
Oh yes, you had all through life, particularly when you were young, sort of people you loved, special people. That's right. Yes, and also later on, this satisfying group of people who had to do with the arts, really. Yes, especially people like James Turner, who's been dead these many years, but to be with him in a pub, just talking about books and things, I used to think was
what. Did he write? I mean, I...
Well, that's a terrible thing. I was looking at my library the other day, and there are all these novels and things no one will ever reread. But he wrote a lot of essays and some poetry. I sometimes, out of duty and respect for him, read a poem called Church Clock Winding. In his village, not far from here, the man who wound the church clock up once a week was ill, and James used to climb up the stairs and do this for him until he got better. And he wrote this poem, Church Clock Winding. I think it was a lovely poem, really. Eventually the Turners moved to Cornwall, where they tried to persuade me to live once, where John Nash used to paint. I think I miss talking books to him more than to anyone. His wife was a kind of slightly irritable woman. I think she just didn't really like all this talk about literature and things in pubs. And there's the Irish poet W.R. Rogers. And R.N. Curry, who's one of the, he was one of those scholars who went from the Empire, I don't know what they're called, from the Empire to Oxford. Rhodes Scholar, they were.
Rhodes
Scholar, that's right, yeah. But they were all older than me. But I liked being with them. and like going to yesterday to talk to him. He's like 40 people, it seemed. All fairly young. I thought how delightful they all were, wonderful. But I don't know much about modern life. I can't do a lot of the things. I have travelled, I've been to Australia and the United States and to Sweden and all, more than once.
But you travel like Marvel in his garden in your mind.
Yeah, very much so. Yes, yes, it's a Marvel wonder.
The mind transcending these finds, finds other lands and other seas. Including, I think you mentioned, to a Chinese village.
Oh yes, that's report from a Chinese village by this Swedish couple, which began this series, that's right, yes.
That started the series which led to Akenfield.
It did, yeah. Yes, that's right.
And you enjoyed that book?
I thought it was a marvellous book. Mm. The main reason being that this man and his wife, who were trained sociologists, having reached this mountainside village in this Chinese province, and spent the night, or two nights, and had the wit to know there's no point in going any further. The whole of China, in a sense, was there. And they read it. It's a wonderful book.
Hmm.
Yes.
Did you, in some ways, hope or feel that Akenfield was like this, that you were penetrating to a deeper level of...
I suppose so. But you see, it's difficult. The book's become so well known that I didn't intend to do anything remarkable. But I suppose at the time I was the only person who got both this literary culture and this background, which they came together.
Hmm.
And I had no training in to do such a thing. I just listened to people, some of them might have been my uncles and aunts. And I had actually watched The Old Harvests, which should help with me, in fact, with the sheaves in the fields and things like that. I didn't know when to stop it. One of the great things was the grave digger at the end. I remember cycling to see him and coming across his scenes of deep eccentricity, which I used to see sometimes. And it was startling. Episode really. Well, as I say, then I marked it out kind of class-wise to a degree and age-wise and the two world wars and things like that, just touching on them. But I had written this book, The Age of Illusion, which was...
What was the illusion? Illusion.
That there would be peace in our time. In 20 years, the Second World War had broken out. This, if I say so, it's a very good chapter in it on the Spanish Civil War. These. And also the Western Front. I've forgotten what all the others are. It did very well. It's always in print.
How much was it influenced by your father's experience in Gallipoli?
A good bit, in a way, yes. There was a... they often say now he didn't talk about it, but it's perfectly true of my father. I never asked him any questions, really.
Mm.
And he was this handsome boy. He went there. He never told us anything, really. But what he never did do, he wouldn't go to the Remembrance Day services in the church or anything like that. I think he'd seen through what he himself thought of as the disgrace of it all.
Your father's bitterness about the way the troops were betrayed by the generals and so on in Gallipoli. Have you ever...
Oh, it wasn't my father really so much. That was a common thing at that time, yes. Yes, Churchill was behind it all.
Yes.
Yes, and people hated him really for it. He tried to put, he was only 40 when he had this notion of coming up behind. But he never really lived it down.
So, I think actually, unless there's anything you would have liked me to have asked you, can you think of anything particularly? But and there's so many things in your life, you've done so much, but we've covered this very...
I live very much in the present. There's a lot of writers and people that live very much in the past, I suppose, or according to their age, when they were young or middle. I don't do any of those things, really. I live... I always feel young when I wake up, and I garden and write and do these traditional rural things. That's right, yes. But now and again you think, well, it can't last much longer. But not with any sadness, it just seems rational. I've been very fortunate in many ways.
But you have a wonderful memory.
Very good memory, yes.
Which helps as a writer.
Yes, yes. Things make a huge impression on me, really. I think it must seem pretty odd to a lot of people who come here. There's a man all by himself in this house in the middle of nowhere. But it seems quite normal to me.
Yeah, it seems normal to me, and a wonderful, wonderful life. So, thank you so much.
It's a pleasure.
John Clare, of which, whose society you are, the endless president of, and this is your writing desk.
Yes.
And show me how you write. You like to write by hand?
The Queen, somebody asked the Queen, she said to somebody that she kept a diary. And the man said, do you write by hand, Mum? She said, how else?
Well, you could write with a typewriter, but...
Yes, that's right, yeah.
And so you face away from the window.
Yes, it's only because it's wonderful animals and things like that, yes. Yes.
Too distracting.
Yes, that's right, yes. The light falls on the paper too. So.
So you don't have much on your desk when you're writing?
No, this has got to be sorted out and put it in the way, that's right. Mm-hmm.
And you have a pad or something like that you write on?
Yes, I suppose so, yes. Yes.
You haven't got them, got it here.
And when I've done it all, Vicky then puts it on the computer.
Yeah. It's a lovely room.
It's nice, isn't it? It's Christine's bedroom. And this was John's studio in here, which is now my bedroom. It's a lovely room too.
This was John Nash's room.
Studio.
Oh.
You also slept in here. The bed was here, that's right. The easel was there.
Is that by him?
No, that's by his wife, Christine.
Oh.
And she was a slave before the First World War. And then... She had glaucoma, she couldn't see very well, she gave up painting. She did that when she was 18. Yeah.